Well, good morning. You guys are glad to be here. Say yes. And we want to invite you to open your Bible to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9 this morning, if you will. We are in a series right now just simply entitled More. Last time we were together, you were challenged to make sure that you were seeking to be more of who God really saved you to be. See, the Lord Jesus Christ did not save you and then forget about you. He actually has a desire for you to grow in your grace and knowledge, grow in your relationship with Him. In fact, last week we were encouraged to make sure that we were speaking up because God is listening, that we were looking out because God is saving, that we are actually listening because God Himself is speaking, and then we're looking around because God Himself is loving. Well, today what I want to do in this series really is to challenge you to go after one more. So last week was be more, this week is one more. And by this particular phrase right here, what I simply mean is that you would actually go after one more person with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I want to challenge you to think about somebody where you live, where you work, where you play, who does not have a relationship with Jesus, and then be intentional about going to them with the message of hope that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about it. The message that you possess, the message that I possess, has the ability to take someone out of their darkness into the light. It has the ability to challenge individuals to look to the Lord Jesus, who will take off their filthy garments, their sin, and will actually place upon them the royal righteousness of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you and I, as followers of Jesus, are not going after one more, then the question is, who is going to do it? So we've got to be faithful to what the Lord Jesus Christ has actually called us to do. So today, hopefully, this message will be a source of motivation in your life as it has been in mine for so many years. So Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9, verse 36, if you'll stand with me in honor of God's word, and you got your Bible there, say amen. And Matthew chapter 9, verse 36, this is Jesus in the life and ministry of the Lord Jesus. Seeing the people, Jesus felt compassion for them because they were distressed and dispirited, like sheep without a shepherd. Then He said to His disciples, "The harvest is," what does your Bible say? "Plentiful, but the workers are," what does your Bible say? "Few." Now, eyeball to eyeball for just a moment, take a look again at what Jesus said. He's looking out and He sees those who are far from Him. They don't have a relationship with Him. And He says, "The harvest is plentiful." In other words, there are plenty of people out here who would give their heart to Me. But the problem is that the workers are few. I want you to notice this. The problem is never with the harvest. The problem is always with the workers. And that's what Jesus is saying. We've got to have more workers. In fact, He goes on in verse 38 and says, "Therefore beseech the Lord of the harvest." That is, call out to Him. Pray. Speak up. He's listening. And what are we doing? We're beseeching the Lord of the harvest to send out more, what does that say? Workers into the harvest. Now again, looking at this, we're reminded that the problem is not the harvest. The problem is always with the workers. And we want to be workers who are going out into the harvest. We also want to be workers who are praying that God would send out more into the harvest. So let's bow together. Father, this morning, use Your word and the time that we have together to challenge us to live with a one more mentality. That we really would. We would extend ourselves with great intentionality, with great desire, that we might be able to encourage people to be rescued from their sin. And God, we'll give You glory for how You do it. And that's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. And everybody said, amen, amen. So you can be seated this morning. So our key question that is going to kind of guide our time together now that we've launched ourselves off of Matthew chapter 9 is this. What can motivate us to live with a one more mentality? What could motivate us to live with a one more mentality? Now, we'll tell you there are a plethora of answers that you can give to this one simple question. But today, I only want to give you two answers. And I'm going to primarily build those two answers directly from the life and the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was the one who looked upon the crowds. He was the one who felt great compassion. So we want to experience the same feelings that Jesus felt so that we would be motivated as Jesus was motivated to go out into the harvest field. So with that in mind, two major answers. First of all, and jot this one down, it'll be helpful. The miserable future of the unconverted should motivate you to go and live with a one more mentality. The miserable future of the unconverted. By the unconverted here, I obviously mean those who have not come into a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So they are living their lives separate from God, doing their own thing. But there is a miserable future in store for them. In fact, the Lord Jesus Christ talks about the miserable future on many occasions. If you were to pay attention to the teaching and the ministry of Jesus in the Gospels, you would discover that oftentimes the Lord Jesus Christ brings to the surface that which will occur in the lives of those who have not trusted in Him. And He actually, with great boldness, shares the reality of hell, which is awaiting those who have not come to faith in the Lord. In fact, here's a great quote. It may seem remarkable, but no Bible spokesman places more stress on hell as the final consequence of God's judgment of condemnation than Jesus. God's Son was the great theologian of hell. Now, I want you to listen closer, right? Because a lot of times what people say is they say, well, Jesus didn't talk much about hell. They've not read the Bible. Jesus talked a great deal about hell, so much so that this individual says he is the great theologian of hell. So when it comes to what happens to those who are unconverted, we should listen to what Jesus had to say. And then we should be motivated by what Jesus had to say so that we would live with a one more mentality. Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ uses a term in the New Testament to describe hell? And that term is the Greek word Gehenna. G-E-H-E-N-N-A, Gehenna. Now Gehenna, as soon as he used this word in their modern language, they immediately would have thought about a place, because Gehenna was actually the term used to describe the valley south of Jerusalem where locals would dump their garbage. Now, if you've ever seen a city dump, you know the kinds of things that one would find in Gehenna. If you ever seen or you visited a third world country where they throw away their garbage, you get a sense of what Gehenna is like. Gehenna, south of Jerusalem, was a place where everyone's refuge, all of their trash was thrown, and that trash was set on fire. And so because the locals were bringing their trash over and over and often to that one place, that fire never stopped. So they knew, as soon as Jesus mentioned Gehenna, they knew what Gehenna looked like, they knew what Gehenna smelt like, and they also knew what Gehenna felt like because they had gone up to Gehenna themselves. Now, the Lord Jesus Christ uses this term in the Gospels, Matthew chapter 10. Listen to what Jesus says. He says, "Do not fear those who can kill the body, but are unable to kill the soul. But rather fear Him," that is, His Father in heaven, "who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." And it's here that He uses this term, Gehenna. So the Lord Jesus Christ, in His teaching ministry, warns people, listen, don't be afraid of somebody who can just put you to death. You should be fearful of the God of heaven and earth who has the ability to take your body and soul and throw it into hell. In fact, moving a step further, thinking about what Jesus taught concerning hell, He taught that hell is where the unconverted are sent after the final judgment. Now, this is interesting. Those who die today who have not placed their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ do not go directly to the hell that you and I often think of when we think about hell. The hell that you and I think of is actually a future place which God has reserved for those who have rejected Him. Matter of fact, John on the island of Patmos in the book of Revelation had a vision of this great final judgment of unbelievers, those who sought to live apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. And it was in this particular vision that he had an opportunity to see exactly what happens to the unconverted. Listen to what he writes. He says, "Then I saw a great white throne and Him who sat upon it." And by the way, the Him in this text is the resurrected, glorified Jesus Christ. So the Lord Jesus Christ Himself is seated upon this throne. The Bible says, "From whom the presence of earth and heaven fled away, and no place was found for them." Going a step further, He says, "I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne. And books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged from the things which were written in the books according to their deeds. Now, just in this verse alone, you and I get a picture of what happens to those who are unconverted to Christ. They die, and ultimately they will stand before the great white throne judgment. The Bible says here that there will be a plethora of books that are open. That is many books. Now, in these books are written down every sin of the person who is standing before Jesus. Every sin in thought, every sin in word, every sin in deed. Every single sin is collected in these books. And they are opened up and they are read so that the unconverted hears their offense against the holiness of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there is this other book known as the Book of Life. Now, this book has written inside of it the names of all of those who have placed their faith in the Lord Jesus. And so this individual standing at the great white throne judgment will hear a record of his or her sins. They will see how they have broken the law of God. They will have absolutely nothing to say for themselves. Paul the Apostle says in the book of Romans that the law of God will actually shut their mouths. So they will be unable to defend themselves at this moment. It is clear that they have broken the law of God. Then the book of life is open and their name will not be found in it. Going a step further, John says, the sea gave up the dead which were in them, and death and Hades gave up the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every one of them according to their deeds. Now this is interesting, right? Because there will be some who stand before the Lord Jesus Christ who really did. They believed that they lived a decent life. You know, they gave the shirt off their back. They helped their neighbors who were in need. And as a result, they believed that their good works would impress God. But their good works were self-motivated. Their good works were selfish. And as a result, they will see even those things that they claim to be good as sin against the holy God. Not to mention the overt sins that they commit towards the Lord Jesus Christ in open shame. The Bible says in verse 14, then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. So there's the place you and I typically think of when we think about hell. It is the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. Now listen closely. Those who do not put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ will not just experience one death. According to this passage of Scripture, they will experience two deaths. So they will die separated from God. They will stand at the judgment seat, the great white throne judgment, and then they will be cast into hell, and they will experience death to a whole new level as they experience the full wrath of God upon their lives, according to Jesus, for all of eternity. Now, here's another thing that Jesus teaches. He answers this question, where are the unconverted prior to the final great white throne judgment? Because I think that's a great question, right? If somebody is an unbeliever today and they die, where do they go? If hell, the lake of fire, as we think of it, is after the great white throne judgment, and that is in the future, where do these individuals go when they die without Jesus? Well, the answer is given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, when you study the life and ministry of Jesus, you will discover that oftentimes when he teaches, that he uses what we call couplets. They are two images or two metaphors side by side. And in Luke's Gospel, chapter 16, the Lord Jesus Christ introduces to you and I two individuals. There's one by the name of the rich man, and then there's another one by the name of Lazarus. Now, Jesus sets the scene. He says, the rich man lived a life of ease. He filled up his life with just absolute frivolous living. He gave himself over to whatever his flesh desired. He had it all. Then there was this poor man. This poor man actually sat outside the gates of the rich man. The poor man's name was Lazarus. And he would sit there and he would wait upon that rich man or anyone else who was leaving that house so that he could beg just for a meal, beg just for a coin. He was just scratching, seeking to get by. Jesus then talks about these two men and how they both actually died. One of them went into heaven, one of them went into what Jesus describes as Hades. As a matter of fact, listen to what Jesus says. He says, in Hades, he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and he saw Abraham far away and Lazarus in his bosom. So Jesus now is telling you what happened to the unconverted in this text of Scripture. The rich man immediately went into Hades. Hades is almost like this holding place in preparation for the great final judgment, which happens at the great white throne judgment, which we just read about in the book of Revelation. But this rich man is now considered a very poor man. He is in Hades, lifting up his eyes. He is in, what does that say? Say it out loud with me. Torment. Now, this particular term is a strong term in the Greek New Testament because it describes what this rich man who's now in Hades actually is experiencing. The torment here is a word that literally describes severe pain or unrelenting suffering. There's nothing he can do to get rid of the torment that he is experiencing in his own life. He is conscious of it. He is absolutely feeling the weight of his unconverted life being poured down upon him. Now, Lazarus, on the other hand, was that poor man. This is interesting. The poor man now becomes a rich man. You see, the reality is that the rich man denied Jesus and became poor. The poor man accepted Jesus and became rich. And in this particular text of Scripture, what we see is that Lazarus is leaning against Abraham's bosom. It gives the imagery of this now rich man seated around a banquet table, leaning in or leaning over on Abraham. He's experiencing great bliss as a result. Now, Jesus goes on. He says, and he cried out. And he said, now, by the way, this is the man who's in Hades. He cried out and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Now, eyeball to eyeball for just a moment. Whenever this man in Hades cries out, Father Abraham, it gives rise to the reality that he was a Jewish man. It's only those of a Jewish descent who would claim Abraham to be their father. And so here in this text, what we see and are reminded of, and I believe Jesus was trying to teach very plainly, is that a person will not spend eternity with God in glory just because they're Jewish. So this Jewish man now is in Hades. He says, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus so that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I am in agony in this flame. Think about the fascinating irony of this text of Scripture. The rich man used to leave his house while Lazarus was outside the gate begging for food. No doubt he probably walked by him several times and completely ignored him. But now this rich man who has become poor is looking up at the poor man who has become rich, and he's saying, send him over just to drop a little water on my tongue. I am in agony. Now, this is another word that describes the feelings that this rich man who's now poor in Hades felt while he was there. We've already seen the word torment, now the word agony. It describes a mental anguish as well as a physical anguish. In fact, when you study that word from the Greek New Testament, you will see that it describes unstoppable worry and unstoppable panic. Now, I want you to let that sink in for just a moment. Have you ever had a panic attack? Have you ever just been so worried that you almost became immobilized? You couldn't move. You were just so overstricken with panic. Imagine the fact that that never fades, that never stops. That's the imagery that Jesus gives us of someone who dies unconverted. They are in Hades and they're experiencing mental anguish. But also there's the physical reality. That same word also means unyielding suffering. So there is suffering that this man is experiencing that he cannot shake. He cannot move himself, maneuver himself, get in a different space so that there is any relief whatsoever. It's just not going away. It is there and it is there to stay. Going a step further, we know that Jesus goes on to show how in Hades, there's no opening, there's no outlet, there is no exit. Now, there are some who actually teach this. They teach that if a person dies without placing their faith in Christ, that they'll get a second chance. But the reality is that is not taught anywhere in the Scripture. If you reject the Lord Jesus Christ and you die, there is no second chance. You are immediately placed in Hades, and there is no outlet, there is no exit from the wrath of Almighty God. Listen to what Jesus says. Besides all of this, between us and you, there's a great chasm fixed, so that those who wish to come over from here to you will not be able, and that none may cross over from there to us. So imagine what Jesus is doing. He's painting this picture of the man who is in Hades, who has the ability to see over into Abraham's bosom, over into that great banquet, and he wants to go. But then the reality comes. No. Nobody can come from here to there or there to there. You are stuck. There is absolutely no exit whatsoever. And Jesus also states that there will be many who find this miserable future. Now, this is pretty huge, right? Because we went from a couplet of the rich man and Lazarus. Now I want you to see another couplet. This is the couplet of a wide gate and a narrow gate. And this is what Jesus taught. So listen to what Jesus says. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction. And there are, what does that say? Say it out loud with me. Many who enter through it. Now, the reason that this verse has always fascinated me is because I'm aware, just as many of you are, that Jesus lived a life without sin. That means Jesus did not tell a lie. He never told a lie. So here in this verse, he's saying, listen, there are many people who are going to find this broad way that actually leads to destruction. So many, imagine that. Several people are on their way, even today as I'm preaching, to hell, to spend eternity separated from God. Jesus then goes on and says, but the gate is small, and the way is narrow that leads to life. And there are, what does that say? Yeah, it says few who find it. So what has Jesus done? He says, listen, there's this large gate, tons of people are walking down it, but then there is this very narrow gate, and there's only a few who will find it. And again, the reason this strikes me is because Jesus did not lie. So he is telling the truth. There are more people who will spend eternity separated from God in Hades, in hell, experiencing his divine wrath for all of eternity. There'll be more people there than there will be in heaven. Jesus also explains how there will be unconverted people among those who are true followers while on earth. Now, I want you to think about this, because he moves from a different couplet. He's got the rich man, he's got Lazarus, we got the wide gate, we got the narrow gate. But Jesus also tells this parable where he talks about the wheat and the tares, or the wheat and the weeds. Jesus actually talks about how the wheat and the weed look exactly alike as they're growing up. They grow up together among one another, and you can't tell one from the other. So much so, and he says, listen, don't go out there and try to harvest the field. Don't go out there yet and try to pick out the weeds, because if you do, you might actually pull the wheat up with the weeds. So here, what Jesus does is describe how unconverted people they grow up with, they hang out with, genuine followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. They look the same, they may talk the same, they may act the same, but they've never genuinely placed their faith in Jesus. Listen to what Jesus says about them. He says, just as the tares, that's the weeds, just as the tares are gathered up and burned with fire, so shall it be at the end of the age. So what he's doing here is he is describing what actually happens to those who look like they are converts, but they're not. Jesus says, the Son of Man, that is, he's speaking of himself, is going to send forth his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom the stumbling blocks and those who have committed lawlessness. So think about the imagery of Jesus, which Jesus Christ gives to us. He says, listen, there's going to come a time when I'm going to send out my angels, my holy angels, who will go and they will find the unconverted souls, and they will take them and they will throw them into the furnace of fire. That's exactly what Jesus says here. They will be thrown into the furnace of fire. In that place, there will be weeping and there will be gnashing of teeth. Now, again, I want you to realize this morning that this is what Jesus taught. You know, oftentimes when we think about what Jesus taught, we always go to those things, maybe like heaven. You know, he's prepared a place for us, and those are all in the scripture as well. But Jesus talked more about the unconverted's future than he did about the converted's future in glory. He made this a main theme of his life and ministry. He made this a main theme in his preaching and in his teaching. If you were sitting there listening to Jesus teach, you would invariably hear the Lord Jesus Christ talking about the miserable future of the unconverted. But also we know that Jesus taught, not only will unrighteous people be doomed, but so will those who seem to know God but do not actually know him. Now, where do we get this? We get it again from Jesus. Matthew 7, he says, "Not everybody who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will inherit the kingdom of God. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter." So notice what Jesus does. He says, listen, just because somebody calls me Lord, you are the master, right? You are the Lord. Just because they have this verbal acknowledgement of a name of Jesus does not mean that they're going to spend eternity with him in glory. In fact, Jesus says, many will say to me on that day, "Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Lord, did we not in your name cast out demons, in your name perform many miracles?" Now, this is interesting because what it does is it gives you and I another picture of someone standing before the Lord Jesus Christ at the great white throne. And after they realize their fate for all of eternity is separation, maybe some would say, "But wait a minute, don't you remember what we did? Don't you remember we used to preach about you? Don't you remember we used to do miracles and we would use your name? Don't you remember we used to cast out demons and we would use your name? Don't you remember what we did?" You see, the reality is some people are banking on their works to get them into glory. But it is not the work of man that will get you into the glory of God. It is not your works that will get you there. It is only the work of the Lord Jesus Christ that will get you there. Jesus is elevating this. He says, "I will declare to them in that day, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" Now, this is huge, right? This means that there are those who come to Concord who are not genuine converts to the Lord Jesus Christ. They may have done some ministry. They may have been on some mission trips. They may have sang some songs. They may have listened to some sermons, but they don't know the Lord. And one day they're going to stand before the Lord and all of the books are going to be open and they're going to see their names not in the book of life. And maybe they will say, "But didn't I go to church? Didn't I do this? Didn't I do that?" And he will say, "I never knew you. Depart from me." What a strong statement from the Lord Jesus. And I want you to know that belief isn't enough. Just you claiming you believe. And I grew up in church, man. I believe all that stuff. Yeah, I believe that. I believe it. Yeah, Jesus, I believe he died. I believe he was buried. I believe he was resurrected. I believe that stuff, man. Yeah, I'm good. I believe. James tells us in the New Testament, even the demons believe, and yet they shudder. So just because you can verbally assent to this idea of belief doesn't mean you actually know the Lord Jesus. And this should drive us as followers of Christ to encourage people. Listen, don't just bank on a belief that has not changed you. A lot of people are doing this. Matter of fact, I want you to know that the demons believe and they even know that the judgment of God is coming their way. In the life and ministry of Jesus, he cast out many demons. On some occasions, the demons would actually talk back to him. And on one occasion, the demon said, "Wait a minute, Jesus, you're not here to judge us before our time, are you?" So the demons believed in Jesus. They believed that he was the great judge, and they even believed that judgment was coming for them. But that does not convert a demon. So how do you think it will convert you? No wonder. Jesus looked over the people, and no wonder he was filled with compassion. Because as he describes them, they were dispirited, they were distressed, they were like sheep without a shepherd. And when he says compassion, this particular term in the Greek New Testament gives us the idea of someone's inner bowels being turned over. In other words, when Jesus looked at those who were far from God, when he saw those who were one breath away from spending eternity separated from him, it physically made him sick to his stomach. Now I want to ask you, when you look out across where we live, does it make you sick to your stomach that people don't know Christ? And I pray for this in my own life, Pray for this in the church of the Lord Jesus. Remember the rich man in Hades. This is interesting because the rich man in Hades who got no relief, he was in torment, he was in agony. The Bible says that he stated, I beg you, Father. I beg you. And by the way, this idea of beg, it's not like this little pleading. It's a little whimper. This is a vehement, loud, screaming, hollering, beating of the chest kind of beg. I beg you that you, Father, since Lazarus can't come and put water on my tongue, here's what I ask that you would do, that you would send him to my Father's house on earth. For I have five brothers, in order that he may warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment. It is an amazing concept that those who currently have died without Christ have a greater desire to see lost people be saved than even us. And yet that's the cry of this particular man. What can motivate us to live with one more mentality? I think this is one. The miserable future of the unconverted. Because some of these who are in the unconverted camp are your friends, are your family members, are your neighbors, are your coworkers, right? And you and I, as followers of Jesus, are not just called to kind of walk right by them, even though they're on the way to hell, and not say anything. We're called to influence them. We're called to share with them, which really leads me to the second statement. Jot this one down. You and I should be motivated because of the miraculous message of the converted. The miraculous message of the converted. That is, you have a message, I have a message that is given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ that we are actually called to share. I love what Paul says. He says it like this. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Notice the word ashamed. Here's what he's saying. I'm not shrinking back. I'm not hiding. I'm not being quiet. I am unashamed. Unashamed of the gospel. The good news of Jesus, that he died for your sins, was buried and resurrected, and those who turn to him can be forgiven and can know eternity with God in heaven. I'm not ashamed of that message, Paul says. That's why I speak. That's why I travel from city to city to city, because I want to take the message of Jesus to as many people as I possibly can. I'm not ashamed. But then he makes this statement. It is the power of God. And I love this. In the gospel, Paul says, is the power of God for salvation to whoever believes, to the Jew first, then also to the Greek. Now, this word power is dunamis. It's the idea of power on reserve. In other words, in the gospel message is so much power to save that there is power on reserve. Now, you think about that. That means there is no one who is too far gone. There's nobody who's so sinful, nobody in your family that you're like, they're a basket case, they'll never be saved. There's nobody so far out there that the gospel of Jesus Christ does not have the ability to save. And you have the message. I have the message. In fact, I would say it to you like this. There are no other people on the planet who have the cure to reaching one more but followers of Jesus. And think about the glorious message of Jesus Christ. It is a message of great hope. It is a message that has the power to open blinded eyes, a message that has the power to soften the hardest hearts, a message that has the power to justify the most wretched sinner. It is a message that has the power to make righteous the unrighteous, a message that has the power to free us from sin's bondage, a message that has the power to rescue us from condemnation. His message has the power to deliver us from the miseries of hell and grant us a home in heaven. That's the message that you have, that I have, and so the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You and I are called to take this message. Listen, if we don't take it, who will? If you, as a follower of Christ, as I, as a follower of Christ, if we are not seeking to win one more to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, then what are we doing? And if this is the mission of the church, If this is the mission of the church, go one more, go one more, go get another one, go get another. If that's the mission of the church, but all we really do is kind of get together with one another every weekend and look at each other, then we're not following Jesus. I don't know what we're doing. This is the call. And if we're not following the call, then we're not following the one who gave the call. So who's your one more? Where you live, who's that one more who needs Christ? In your neighborhood, who's that one more that needs Christ? Where you work, who's that one more who needs Christ? When you are looking out as Jesus looked out over the harvest. Remember, the problem is not with the harvest. The problem is always with the worker. And who is the worker? It is us. That's where the problem lies. 2016, a movie came out, many of you I'm sure saw it, entitled Hacksaw Ridge. It was a story of a man who went to war but would not shoot a gun. And then this particular story, which was fascinating to me, towards the end of the movie, his side was just being whipped up on one way to the other. And he was walking up and he envisioned all of these bombs that were going off, all of this fire that was occurring, and he began to pray, Lord, what do you want me to do right now? And I want you to watch his response. And I want you to listen to his response, and I want you to ask the question, are you living with that kind of one more mentality? Watch this.
What is it you want of me? I can't hear you.
Okay, we got you. We got you.
Hey, Ted. It's me, it's Desmond. I'm gonna fix you up. You ready to get out of here?
I sure am.
Please, Lord, help me get one more. Help me get one more. Get one.
So this is the question to answer. Let's bow together. Father, help us to live in such a manner that we are always driven to get one more. And after we get that one more, we want to go after another. And Lord, thank you for your patience. You're not willing that any would perish, but all would come to everlasting life. Help us to live like Paul the Apostle, unashamed of this message, intentional about carrying it to the next group of people, the next city, the next person. Lord, help us to live like this. We don't want to waste our lives. And thank you for the great privilege as well that we have to carry this great, phenomenal message of hope. With your heads bowed, your eyes closed, nobody's looking around this morning. You may be here today and you've not genuinely given your heart to Christ. Maybe even as I was preaching about the wheat and the tares or the wide gate, the narrow gate, the rich man, Lazarus, you realized God bearing down upon your chest saying, that is you. You may have been in church all your life, baptized several times, etc. I mean, you name it, you've done all the religious stuff, but you've never come into a relationship with the Lord. God's made that true. God's affirmed that in your heart. Don't deny Him. Don't be ashamed to surrender your life. So the Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I want to encourage you to do that this morning. Maybe God's calling, and now it's time for you to call, Lord, save me. Pray something like this. Just say, Lord, I admit to you that I'm a sinner, and I believe that Jesus died for me and was resurrected. And so today, the best way I know how, I'm turning from my sin, putting my full trust in you. Forgive me. Take away my sin. Give me your righteousness. And help me to be unashamed of this decision. With your heads bowed, your eyes closed, if that's the prayer of your heart, first step of obedience is baptism. We're going to celebrate that in the days ahead. We'd love to set up a time for you to be baptized as well. That's you going public with your faith. So if you just gave your heart to Jesus, first step of obedience is baptism. So when we stand to our feet in just a moment, I'm going to invite you to leave the place where you've been seated. Come forward. I'll be here in the front. Want to pray for you, help you along, encourage you in your walk with Christ. But you may have to ask somebody to slide out your way. Ask them. They would love to do that. But also, I want to say this morning, to those of you who are followers of Jesus, would you pray that God would break your heart? That He would break your heart with what breaks His? This life is not about you. It's not about me. It's about the Lord Jesus, about others coming to know Him, getting into the family. It's about us going out and encouraging others to do just that. Are you living that way? And Father, thank you for just a reminder of what your Son, Jesus, taught while here upon the earth. Help us to be unashamed of this message. Would you do something in the life of our church family? Lord, I just can't imagine what it would be like if every person here, every person on every campus, every follower of Jesus lived with this kind of mentality. What would it look like? What would happen? God, that's what I pray. So, Lord, we give you the invitation. We trust that you'll work today. Give courage to those who need to come and help us to pray that you would break our heart with what breaks yours. And that's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. And while we sing this morning, you come as God is calling you.